Hey, ¿cómo están? ¿Qué pex, racita? Ya voy, ya voy, ya voy. ¿Qué onda? Ya se están conectando. Chido, de racilla conectada. Un segundo, déjame más cambiar este pex. Tengo que arreglar unos temas del chat. No, lo voy a dejar aquí, súper bien. Aquí tengo el chat, aquí tengo este pex. Chido. Vamos a cambiar la capa de views y ya puedo poner. Esto voy a cerrar, esto voy a cerrar, esto lo voy a poner en grande. ¿Cómo están? ¿Qué me falta para las subs? Güey, es un pedo ese tema de las subs, güey. O sea, necesito. Creo que 12 días seguidos con 75 personas conectadas en el stream. Y la neta está bien difícil, güey. Porque la hora que streameo, que es normalmente ahorita 4 y media, 5, hay bien poquita gente. O sea, creo que voy a tener que streamear de que más al final del día. Entonces todavía le falta, todavía le cuelga. Pero pues gracias por estar aquí de todas formas. Eso es lo que importa. Lo que importa es la amistad. El valor más importante es la amistad, chicos. Mientras seamos amigos, todo va a estar bien. ¿Cuál sería la medida básica para evitar la monopolización de las plataformas? Pues prácticas antimonopólicas. O sea, para empezar, tienen que dejar de permitir que las empresas capitalicen sobre bienes de dominio público para generar dinero. O sea, la explicación rápida es esta. Imagínate, supuestamente Google te da un servicio que es un navegador, un buscador de Internet a cambio de tus datos, ¿no? O sea, ellos se quedan con tus datos y tú puedes navegar Internet gratis. Para empezar, el navegador está completamente sesgado porque se sabe por un hecho que Google le da favoritismo. Las primeras dos páginas, básicamente, no son cosas tanto que tengan que ver con tu search, sino que son páginas que pagan publicidad en Google. Ese es el problema. Y el segundo punto que es muy importante es que, pues obviamente no es proporcional porque tú das tus datos por un servicio muy barato. Y Google se vuelve millonario. Entonces, definitivamente ellos le están sacando muchísimo más dinero y turnover a tus datos y a tu atención que lo que tú estás recibiendo a cambio. O sea, no es un valor proporcional. Si fuese un valor proporcional, no sería una empresa multitrillonaria con las ganancias que tiene. O sea, ¿de dónde viene el spread entre lo que tú recibes y lo que ellos ganan? ¿Me explico? Entonces, ahí es donde hay muchos temas familiares. Déjame nada más, voy a postear. Bueno, voy a asegurarme que se haya posteado bien esta cosa. Ok, chill. Ya hay suficiente gente viendo esto. Súper, ok. Vamos a ver la entrevista. Esta es una entrevista, dicen que está súper controversial. Acaba de salir, literal salió ayer, de Trump ¿Se puede hacer subtítulos en otro idioma? ¿Dónde puedo ver los idiomas subtítulos? Subtítulos en inglés, fuck. Bueno, ni modo, gente, van a tener que ver la entrevista con subtítulos en inglés, espero entienden. Si no entienden, me dicen y voy revisando algunas cosas en el chat, ¿ok? Voy a tratar de no pararla tanto para que se sienta más fluida, la voy a poner en 1.5 y vamos revisando a ver qué pasa. Híjole, extraño Game of Thrones con ese sonidito, maldita sea, güey. Dicen que este güey es un muy buen asesor político. Axios. Okay.
Thank you so much for having us. We're already in, Mr. President. Thank you. Kelly.
Ah, y está Kelly Conway.
Mr. President, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
We appreciate you taking the time, good. And we appreciate your commitment to answer our questions.
Sure.
Really appreciate that. Over the years, I've heard you talk about your adherence to a philosophy called positive thinking. This is the mantra that if you believe something, if you visualize it, then it will happen.
¿Cómo? ¿Es neta? ¿Trump cree en el pensamiento positivo? Güey, mi teoría de que la derecha conservadora está vinculada al pensamiento positivo empieza a ganar una fuerza bien cabrona, si esto es verdad, lo voy a tener que investigar. Vergas, güey, claro que es pensamiento de gurú. Digo, obviamente, yo entiendo todo el trasfondo ideológico y filosófico de por qué, pero no sabía que Trump creía en eso. A ver.
To an extent, I also think in terms of the downside.
Right.
I've been given a lot of credit for positive thinking, but I also think about downside, because only a fool doesn't.
To what extent do you think that positive thinking mindset is suitable to handling the worst pandemic that we've seen in a century?
I think you have to have a positive outlook, otherwise you would have nothing without a positive outlook. I think we've done an incredible job between the ventilators and stopping very infected people from China coming in, meaning putting the ban on China.
Güey, esta parte de Trump, o sea, esta como vagina o labia majori que se hace justo abajo de su quijada, me parece asqueroso, asqueroso, güey. Traten de no distraerse, pero el chile, esta parte de su cuello es algo grotesco.
China, which frankly nobody wanted me to do, practically because it was very early in January. Then putting the ban on Europe, not an easy thing to do. When you put a ban on Europe, that's a big thing. We would have probably lost hundreds of thousands of lives more had I not done that. And all of the experts, every one of them, not one of them wanted.
Quiero... Sí, ya sé, está cabrón, perdón. Otro comentario. Trump se hizo una operación del pelo súper rara, donde haz de cuenta que te cortan un pedazo del pelo aquí enfrente. Tipo, te cortan un pedazo del cráneo aquí enfrente, lo doblan y te lo pegan aquí a un lado de la cabeza. Por eso tiene el pelo así tan raro, güey. Quiero... Ve, chécate, a ver si puedo encontrarlo. Trump, hair surgery. A ver, vamos a ver. Miren. Aquí se debe ver dónde está. ¿Es esta? No es esta. Es esta, vean. O sea, quiero que vean esto. Esta es la operación que Trump se hizo en la cabeza. ¿Dónde está? Esta, vean esto. O sea, literal, tipo, como es gente que le crece nada más en la coronilla, o sea, nada más le crece tipo en los laterales, te cortan un... O sea, esto es una operación muy antigua que ya no se hace, ¿no? Pero se cuenta que lo que te hacen es te cortan un pedazo del cráneo aquí y luego lo voltean y te lo pegan aquí enfrente, para que no tengas las entradas tan pronunciadas. Entonces, obviamente tu cabeza se ve toda torcida, porque literal te arrancaron un pedazo de un lado, lo cerraron, y luego te lo pegan enfrente para que te nazca cabello enfrente. Esa es la cirugía que tiene Trump. O sea, sinceramente es algo muy, 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 muy raro lo que tiene. O sea, vean aquí, tipo aquí al lado es donde sale el cabello, y se lo pegan acá enfrente. Por eso tiene el pelo así tan mandado a la fregada de que todo extraño. O sea, es una cirugía muy antigua, Y muy mal hecha, o sea, tiene resultados muy, muy feos. Vean esto, güey. El pelo de Trump, la neta, es algo también bien raro. X. Digo, lo estoy mencionando porque muchos de esos atributos físicos de la persona reflejan algunas cosas de sus características. Y a grandes rasgos esto habla de una persona que está manteniendo apariencias, ¿no? O sea, está aparentando ser algo que realmente no es. O sea, un mentiroso patológico, por decirlo así.
The criticism of you that is most prominent is about the communication. It's the public health experts saying that it needs to be based in reality. And they're saying that the wishful thinking and the salesmanship is just not suitable at a time when a pandemic has killed 145,000 Americans. And it's that I understand what you're saying, that people need to hear positive thinking. But, you know, for the past 5 months, it's been the virus is totally under control. And the cases have been going up in the deaths of
look.
But you've been saying it's
nobody
under control.
Nobody knew what this thing was all about. This has never happened before. 1917, but it was a totally different, it was a flu in that case, okay? But other than 1917, there's never been anything like this. And by the way, if you watch the fake news on television, they don't even talk about it. But you know, there are 188 other countries right now that are suffering, some proportionately far greater than we are, okay? As bad as we
very
are.
Very few.
Some proportionately greater than we are. Right now, Spain is having a big spike. There are tremendous problems in the world. You look at Moscow, look at what's going on with Moscow, look at Brazil, look at these countries, what's going on.
O sea, pura diversión, yeah. Okay. Tipo, yo no soy malo, los otros están peor. No mames, inmediatamente lo hizo de Estados Unidos contra China. Está loco, güey, comprándose esta pelea con China. No le conviene, güey. O sea, si Estados Unidos ya está temblando en términos de su poder hegemónico y económico, cultural y político sobre el mundo, ahorita es el peor momento para meterte en pedos con China, porque llevas todas las de perder, güey. O sea, yo sinceramente no veo a Trump ganar otra vez elecciones, pero bueno, vamos a ver.
We were making progress like nobody's ever made progress. They had before the pandemic, they had the worst year, Jonathan, that they've had in 67 years. You know that, with the tariffs and everything else I did. We were taking in billions of dollars. I was giving some of it to the farmers. The farmers were doing well because I was targeting, they were targeting the...
Mentira completa. Vayan a ver cómo estaba el sector agrícola de Estados Unidos después de que este güey empezó a entrar en guerra con China y les estaba llevando el carajo, güey.
Farmers, I was targeting China. We were doing good. Then all of a sudden, the game changed, and I had to close it down. I closed down the greatest economy ever in history. And then... I closed it down, and now we're opening it. And we say, by the way, by closing it down, we saved millions of lives. If we would have gone to herd, and we knew very little about the disease, if we would have gone herd, we would have lost millions of people, millions of people. One person's too much. We're at 140,000 people. One person is too much. We're at 140. We would have lost millions of people. And
qué hueva hablar con él. O sea, qué flojera ser el entrevistador y estar escuchando como este bombardeo de mentiras y diversión. O sea, esto es algo que Calloway, Kanye, o no sé, Kanye, no sé, la güera esta que pasó por detrás, que es su asesora de comunicación, es la autora esta de la idea de los alternative facts, o sea, de los hechos alternativos, que es básicamente todo el proceso de discurso de la derecha. O sea, todo el proceso de discurso de la derecha, los conservadores, los neoliberales, y digo, muchos de izquierda también lo hacen, pero esa a grandes rasgos es la derecha populista conservadora que hace esto de tú les haces una pregunta y en lugar de contestarte lo que tú le estás preguntando, empiezan a hacer una divergencia de la conversación hacia un punto que ellos quieran platicar. Entonces nunca te contestan realmente lo que tú te le estás preguntando. Siempre te contestan algo más. Cagante, qué molesto,
Those people that really understand it, they really understand it, they said it's incredible the job that we've done. And again, I bring
who's, up who
the
says
ban,
that?
The ban banning China from coming in.
It was already in here.
What's
it? It was already here. Like by the time you banned China, it came in through.
Nobody knew the extent. Nobody knew how contagious
it was. The question is, Mr. President,
China
by June, we knew things were bad. And you know, the last time I was with you was the day before your Tulsa rally in the Oval. And you know, you were saying big huge crowd, it was indoors.
By the way,
these people, they listen to you.
Excuse me, Jeff.
Yeah.
We had a 19,000 seat stadium. First of all, we had 12,000 people, not 6,000, which you reported, another paper reported. But you couldn't even get in. It was like an armed camp.
Why would you want
to? 120
that?
Black Lives Matter people.
I understand,
people
but why
there.
Would you want to?
And
a huge
Tulsa,
crowd?
Excuse me, wait. And Tulsa, well, because that area was a very good area at the time. It was an area that was
Cases
pretty much
stuff.
Over. After a month later, it started
before.
Going up. That's a month later. But Tulsa was a very good. Oklahoma was doing very well as a state. It was almost free. It spiked a month later, a month and a half, 2 months later. But it was a good area. We had a tremendous crowd. We had tremendous response. You couldn't even. It was like an armed camp. You couldn't even get through. You couldn't get anybody in.
But I'm
we had 12,000 people. It was incorrectly reported. The other thing we had that nobody wants to talk about. So Fox broadcast it. It was the highest rating in the history of Fox Television Saturday night. It was the highest rating.
Mr. President,
my speech, well, wait a minute, you're saying something.
Yeah.
That speech was the highest rated speech in the history of Fox Television on Saturday night, and nobody says
I
that.
I think you misunderstand me. I'm criticizing your ability to draw a crowd. Are
well,
you kidding me? I've covered you for
this.
5 years. You draw massive
I'm
crowds. You get
this.
Huge ratings. I'm asking about
At
the public
time,
health.
And I canceled another one. I had to cancel it.
Right.
I have a great crowd in New Hampshire, and I canceled it for the same reason.
But here's the question. You know, I've covered you for a long time. I've gone to your rallies. I've talked to your people. They love you. They listen to you. They listen to every word you say. They hang on your every word. They don't listen to me or the media or Fauci. They think we're fake news. They want to get their advice from you. And so when they hear you say everything's under control, don't worry about wearing masks. I mean, these people, many of them are older people,
What's
Mr. President.
What's your definition of control? Yeah. Under the
it's giving them a false sense
right
of security.
Now, I think it's under control. I'll tell you what.
How? 1,000 Americans are dying a day.
They are dying. That's true. And you it is what it is. But that doesn't mean...
Vergas. 1,000 personas muriendo por día y el güey diciendo it is what it is. O sea, está... Es que esta gente está enferma de la cabeza, güey. O sea, literal, yo creo que deberían de ser más estrictos con las pruebas psicológicas contra políticos, porque es una mamada las cosas que hacen. O sea, ¿cómo puedes realmente entregarte y trabajar con vida pública y tener ese nivel de narcisismo tan enfermo? O sea, ¿cómo te puede importar más el hecho de decir, ah, es que en mi rally fue un chingo de gente y los medios no me dan cobertura correcta? Y te dicen, están muriendo 1,000 personas por día y dices, it is what it is, hablemos de cuánta gente fue a mi rally. O sea, ¿qué tan enfermo tienes que estar para realmente tener ese desinterés completo por la vida humana? O sea, ¿son incapaces de aceptar un error o qué pasa, güey? O sea, es que tampoco, bueno.
We are doing everything we can. It's under control as much as you can control it. This is a horrible plague that beset us.
You really think this is as much as we can control?
Well,
1,000 deaths a day?
I'd like to know if somebody, first of all, we have done a great job. We've gotten the governors everything they needed. They didn't do their job. Many of them didn't, and some of them did. Someday we'll sit down. We'll talk about the successful ones, the good ones. Look at that smile. The good ones and the bad. We had good and bad, and we had a lot in the middle. But we had some incredible governors. I could tell you right now who the great ones are and who the not-so-great ones are. But the governors do it. We gave them massive amounts of material.
Mr. President, you changed your message this week in terms of you canceled the Jacksonville convention. You said wear a mask. You're saying, you know, that it's going to get worse before it gets better. It's not something you like to say. I know you said that. The
boy,
big question...
Not get worse like the original flow. You understand that. But
well, I hope not.
Now if you look... Arizona's going down.
If I could just finish my question.
Texas is going down and Florida's going down.
The question is, are you going to, even some of your own aides wonder whether you would stick to that message until election day, whether in a week or two you won't say, right, we've got to reopen again, we can't do this stuff anymore, that you'll get bored of talking about the virus and go back to that
no,
sort of
I'm
cheerleading.
Never get bored. I never get bored of talking about this. It's too big a thing. And again,
so will you stick to that message?
By China. It should have been stopped by China, and it wasn't.
Now it's here.
We
and
have
you're
it
the
here. And I think I'm
you're
very consistent. No, this is a very serious thing. Do you think we have 140,000 people at this moment?
More
this is
that.
A very, very serious situation. And what you have to do is handle it the best it can be handled. And again, I'm working with the governors. I got them tremendous amounts of equipment that they would have never gotten. Jonathan, they wouldn't have equipment now if I didn't get it.
When can you commit, by what date, that every American will have access to the same day testing that you get here in the White House?
Well, we have great testing. We're doing, and
by what date?
People do. Let me explain. The testing.
We have tested more people than any other country, than all of Europe put together times two. We have tested more people than anybody ever thought of. India has 1.4 billion people. They've done 11 million tests. We've done 55. It'll be close to 60 million tests. And, you know, there are those that say, you can test too much. You do know that.
Who says that?
Oh, just read who? The manuals. Read the books.
Manuals?
Read the
what
books.
Manuals?
Read the books.
What books?
What testing does.
Who, no, sorry, just, wait a minute. Said,
let me explain. What testing does, it shows cases. It shows where there may be cases. Other countries test. You know when they test? They test when somebody's sick. That's when they test. And I'm not saying they're right or wrong. Nobody's done it like we've done it. We've gotten absolutely no credit for it.
Months.
But we've come up with so many different tests. The only thing that we have now is some people have to wait longer than we'd like them to. We
it's
want
a big problem.
We want point to point. We want to have a 5 minute to a 15 minute.
Right.
Test.
When
we
do you
have,
think?
And like many others,
every American.
I understand we're close to 50% where it's point-to-point tests. We are making thousands of instruments, thousands of tests right now, tens of thousands that can be distributed to various parts of the country. But you have to understand, and we've even sent some of them to other countries where they had a big problem. Jonathan, almost 50%, in fact, I think the number might be over, is immediate testing. The other's tough. You take a test, you have to send it to a laboratory. Let's say that takes a day, let's
right.
say it's a day.
It's difficult.
You know, so it's 3 or 4 or 5 days. There's nothing you can do about that.
But when do you think you'll have it?
I everyone? Think that you okay. will have that relatively soon. I mean,
what again, that
you already have half.
Yeah.
I would much rather get back to you because I don't okay. want to have you right in 1 month.
That's
I didn't
fine.
Make it. I missed it by a day. It's a headline.
Mr. I want to talk about the federal intervention.
Excuse me, one thing I would say about testing. Because we test so much, we show cases. So we show many, many cases. We show tremendous number of, I know you're smiling when I say
no,
that.
But I mean, I've heard you say this.
Other countries don't test like we do, so they don't show cases.
Just a couple points on that. I wasn't going to continue on the testing, but you said it. So we're testing so much because it's spread so far in America.
We're testing so much because we had the ability to test.
Okay.
Because we
but,
came up with this.
South Korea.
Jonathan, we didn't even have a test. When I took over, we didn't even have a test. Now, in all fairness,
why
there was no test
why
for this.
How would you have a test?
Okay. There was no test for this. No, we didn't have a test because there was no
of
test.
Course.
In a very short order, we got one test, we got another test.
It was
many
first.
Of those tests are now obsolete because we've, you know, it's called science and all of a sudden something's better. But because we tested so many people, 55, 60 million people very soon, we get cases. You test, some kid has even just a little runny nose, it's a case. And then you report many cases. So we
have a lot of
China, which by the way doesn't report, as you know. The point is, because we are so much better at testing than any other country in the world, we show more cases.
The figure I look at is death. And death is going up now.
Okay,
there's 1,000 a day.
If you look at death.
Yeah, it's going up again.
Let's
daily
look.
Death.
Take a look at some of these charts.
I'd love to.
We're going to look.
Let's look.
And if you look at death.
Yeah.
Error,
start going again.
One. Well, right here, the United States is lowest in numerous categories. We're lower than the world.
Lower
than Europe.
In what? In what?
Take a look. Right here. Here's case death.
Oh, you're doing death as a proportion of cases. I'm talking about death as a
muertes en proporciones a casos. Es que, güey, luego se ponen a manipular los números y encuentran estas gráficas donde, es que no se ve tan mal si lo comparas contra, no sé,
güey. Population. That's where the U.S. is really bad.
Well,
much worse than South Korea, Germany, etc.
You can't do that. You have to go by where, look, here is the United States. You have to go by the cases. The cases.
Why not as a proportion of population?
When we have somebody, what it says is when you have somebody that has, where there's a case, the people that live from those cases.
It's surely a relevant statistic to say if the U.S. has X population and X percentage of death of that population versus South Korea.
No, you have to go by the cases.
Well, look at South Korea, for example. 51 million population, 300 deaths. It's like, it's crazy.
You don't know that.
I do. It's
you don't know that.
You think they're faking their statistics? South Korea?
I won't get into that because I have a very good relationship with the country. But you don't know that. And they have spikes. Look, here's
Germany
one.
Low,
here's
9,000?
One. Here's one right here, United States. You take the number of cases.
Okay.
Now look, we're last. Meaning we're first.
Last? I don't know
we
what we're first
best.
In. Is it what?
Take a look.
Okay.
Again, it's cases.
Okay.
And we have cases because of the statistic.
1,000 Americans die a day. I understand. I understand on cases, it's different.
No, but you're not reporting it correctly, Jonathan.
I think I am, but.
If you take a look at this other chart. Look, this is our testing, I believe. This is the testing, yeah.
Yeah, we do more tests.
Now, wait a minute. Well, don't we get credit for that? And because we do more tests, we have more cases. In other words, we test more. We have. Now, take a look. The top one, that's a good thing, not a bad thing. The top, Jonathan.
If hospital rates were going down and deaths were going down, I'd say terrific. You deserve to be praised for testing.
Sí, o sea, entiendo el punto. O sea, en un sentido, tiene razón Trump en decir somos el país que más está haciendo pruebas. Y obviamente, como lo dije desde un principio, o sea, los países de tercer mundo, los que no hicieron pruebas como Brasil, probablemente los números sean 10, 15 veces mayores de los números que se están reportando. Igual en México, igual en Chile, igual en Colombia. Probablemente los números sean muchos mayores porque no hicieron suficientes pruebas. Pero aquí la premisa es, digo, no sé por qué también el reportero está poniendo tan terco. Dile, sí, es verdad, hicimos muchas pruebas. Las pruebas sirven para saber qué tan grave es el problema. ¿Por qué no hicimos nada al respecto para pararlo? O sea, ¿qué pendejo entrevistador, güey? O sea, cabrón, te está poniendo de pechito. Dile, ok, las pruebas son para recibir información sobre el problema. Tienes más información sobre el problema que cualquier otro país del mundo. ¿Por qué no hiciste nada al respecto? O sea, ¿por qué de todas formas abriste la economía? ¿Por qué te tardaste 15 semanas en decir que las máscaras eran importantes? O sea, ¿por qué hiciste el tema de las subastas para el material médico? O sea, tenías toda la información. Hiciste 10 veces más pruebas que los otros países y te diste cuenta que la pandemia era real. Seguías diciendo que no había problema mientras gastabas más dinero en hacer pruebas más que todos los otros países y no hiciste nada al respecto. O sea, ahí, güey, lo tenía de pechito para cogérselo y no lo hizo. O sea, se perdió una muy mala, güey, y no sé por qué está haciendo.
60,000 Americans are in hospital. dying
read the papers. They usually talk about new cases, new cases, new cases.
I'm talking about death.
Will you look at death? Death is way down
from where it was. Están yendo en círculos. Qué aburrido.
It was 2,500. It went down to 500. Now it's going up again.
Excuse me. Where it was is much higher than where it is right now.
Went down and went up again.
But now it's going down again. It's going down in Arizona. It's going down in Florida. It's going down in Texas. Take a look at this. These are the tests.
It's going down in Florida?
Yeah, it's going. It leveled out and it's going down. That's my report as of yesterday.
Anyway, Mr. President, if I can change subject.
It is going down in Arizona.
Arizona it is. Arizona it is. Texas has spiked.
And it spiked and it's now going down in Florida. It's even down and going down in Florida.
I'll have to see this.
But you have to.
Esto es la muerte de la verdad. O sea, esto es la muerte de la verdad. O sea, no permiten, o sea, no se prestan ninguno de los dos para tener una conversación decente. O sea, simplemente están en un concurso de gritos. Oye, es que qué hueva que este sea el nuevo lenguaje de la política. O sea, qué miedo que este sea el nuevo lenguaje de la política. O sea, como si el nuevo lenguaje de la política lo hubiera establecido, ¿sabes? Estos demagogos y... Digo, es culpa de Sam Harris, es culpa de Ben Shapiro, después de todos estos imitadores de Sudamérica, Milei, Gloria Álvarez, Alex, o sea, se volvió un concurso de gritos y un concurso de manipulación de datos y manipulación de estadísticas y de conocimiento simplemente para empujar una agenda ideológica. O sea, sinceramente se me hace muy, 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 muy deprimente.
Look at this. This is the number of tests compared
to the rest
of the world.
I don't deny your figures. You've done more tests by far than the rest.
Right.
I don't deny.
Because we've done more tests, we have more cases.
You have more infections.
Check it out.
Mr. President, different subject. It's been widely reported that the U.S. has intelligence indicating that Russia paid bounties or offered to pay bounties to Taliban fighters to kill American soldiers. Mm-hmm. You had a phone call with Vladimir Putin on July 23rd. Did you bring up this issue?
No, that was a phone call to discuss other things. And frankly, that's an issue that many people said was fake news.
Who said it was fake news?
I think a lot of people. If you look at some of the wonderful folks from the Bush administration, some of them, not any friends of mine, were saying that it's a fake issue. But a lot of people said it's a fake issue.
There was dispute.
We had a call, talking about nuclear proliferation, which is a very big subject. Where they would like to do something, and so would I. We discussed numerous things. We did not discuss that. No.
And you've never discussed it with him.
I have never discussed it with him. I would. I'd have no problem with it.
But you don't believe the intelligence. It's because you don't believe the intelligence. That's why.
Everything. You know, it's interesting. Nobody ever brings up China. They always bring Russia, Russia, Russia. If we can do something with Russia in terms of nuclear proliferation, which is a very big problem, bigger problem than global warming, a much bigger problem than global warming in terms of the real world, that would be a great thing.
No. Claro que no, güey. Ah, qué ganas de agarrar a esta gente a cachetadas. Por supuesto que no es un problema mayor, güey. Putísima madre, güey. Qué tuerto está sus prioridades.
It never reached my desk. You know why? Because they didn't think it was intelligence. They didn't think it was real.
It was in your written brief, though.
They didn't think it was worthy of. I wouldn't mind if it reached my desk. I would have done something about it. It never reached my desk because.
Do you read your written brief?
I do. I read a lot.
Really?
I read a lot. They like to say I don't read. I read a lot.
Your daily.
I comprehend extraordinarily well. Probably better than anybody that you've interviewed in a long time. I read a lot. I spend a lot of time with at meetings. Usually it's once a day or at least two or three times a week. Intelligence.
This was
talking about India. Talking about.
Este vato tiene una cara de que qué hueva va a ser esto, güey. Déjame leer un poquito los comentarios que están acá en el chat, a ver qué están diciendo. La madre, no he visto un chingo. ¿Qué me falta para los subs ya? ¿Cuál sería la medida básica para evitar monopolización? Ya lo contesté. And, best friends. Ya llegué para los golpes. Ñam, 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 ñam. La entrevista me dio mucho cringe. Sí, a mí también me está dando mucho cringe. Ya vi Westworld y me gusta. ¿Es la entrevista de los memes? No. Si piensas positivo, puedes ser presidente. Yay, claro, güey. Es lo que debe pensar este cabrón. Te llegué tarde. Un trader que sigo dice que el imperio caerá. Solo hay que ver cuándo. Pues, sí, yo también creo. ¿Por qué te maltratas tanto viendo estos videos? Este sí lo quería ver. O sea, este sí tenía ganas de ver. Porque, o sea, me interesa mucho cómo se maneja la política en Estados Unidos. Porque impacta a todo el mundo muy cabrón. Trump tiene una patología mental, sí, seria. Siempre le echa el peor resto del mundo. La verdad es que esta es la regla ahorita, ¿eh? O sea, la regla básicamente de la política es que nunca sea problema tuyo. Y básicamente a esto nos hemos desarrollado como adultos, a ser irresponsables. Nadie es capaz de decir, oigan, me equivoqué, perdón, discúlpenme, me equivoqué, tomé una mala decisión, pensé que iba a pasar esto y pasó lo otro, tomé una mala decisión, discúlpenme. No, nadie puede decir eso. Es imposible que un político diga eso. Los políticos siempre están echando pedos a alguien más, siempre es culpa a alguien más. Qué mamada que se compara con India, ya sé, buenas bro, ¿qué le dirías a un trader para callarle la boca? A un trader... Ay, nada, güey, no se junten con esa gente, güey, son como vendedores de droga. O sea, los traders, neta, ignórenlos. Si son sus amigos, dejen de verlos. O sea, en serio, güey, los traders no califican como personas.
With the problems with China, talking about so many different elements of the world. Mm-hmm. The world is a very angry place. If you look all over the world, we call up, I see
22
soldiers were killed in India with China fighting over the border. It's been raging for many, many decades. And they've been fighting and back and forth. I have so many briefings on so many different countries, but this one didn't reach my desk.
The reason I say this is even if you don't believe this particular piece of intelligence, and there is dispute, no doubt, there is dispute in the intelligence community about it, your former, John Nicholson, former head of forces in Afghanistan, said, and this is when he was working for you, that Russia is supplying weapons to the Taliban. Isn't that enough to challenge Putin over the killings of
well,
U.S. soldiers?
Well, we weapons when they were fighting Russia, too. You know, when they were fighting with the Taliban.
It's a different era.
Well, it's a different... I'm just saying, yes.
But does that...
We did that, too. I don't know. I didn't ask Nicholson about that. He was there for a long time, didn't have great success because, you know, he was there before me, and then ultimately I made a change.
But you surely heard that, right? I mean, it's well known in the intelligence community that they're arming the Taliban, Russia.
I don't know. When you say arming, is
supplying
Taliban
weapons.
Paying, or they...
Russia is supplying weapons and money to the Taliban.
I have heard that, but it's never... Again, it's never reached... My desk.
I mean, he said it on the record when he was in...
Hey, Russia doesn't want anything to do with Afghanistan. Let me just tell you about Russia. Russia used to be a thing called the Soviet Union. Because of Afghanistan, they went bankrupt. They became Russia, just so you do understand, okay? The last thing that Russia wants to do is get too much involved with Afghanistan. They tried that once. It didn't work out too
well. Last question on this subject.
And by the way, we're largely out of Afghanistan, as you probably know.
Well, I wanted to ask you about that. The U.S. troop level in Afghanistan right now is roughly the same as it was when
you're wrong. No.
Mr. President, I'm sorry. We have to...
Okay, are you ready?
No.
We'll be down in a very short... It's already planned.
Well that's a different question.
We'll be down in a very short period of time to 8,000. Then we're going to be down to 4,000. We're negotiating right now. We've been there for 19 years.
I know. But if you just let me finish
my
question.
We'll be getting out.
I understand. Look, when you came in, it was 8,800. You boosted to 14,000, and now you're back down to 8,500.
We're now...
My question
we'll
to you...
We'll be in 4,000. I'll give you the exact... Very soon.
What will be the number? Very soon? 4,000?
Very soon, yes.
Like how soon?
I don't want to tell you that.
It's big news.
What is that?
It's going down to 4,000, isn't it?
No, I've always said...
Well, what about election day?
We will get largely out.
On election day, how many American troops will be in Afghanistan?
Probably anywhere from 4,000 to 5,000.
That's almost as many as when you came into office.
No, it's not.
8,000.
We had much more. We had a lot of people over there, too.
8,800.
A lot of people. Troops. And we did a good job. We wiped out ISIS.
Have you thought about going down to zero?
Let me just tell you what you don't say. We took out in Syria, we took out ISIS, we 100% of the caliphate. When I took over Obama, it was totally rampant. ISIS was all over the place. We took them out, we captured them, we killed them. 100%, not 99%. Right. I wanted to get out at 99%. Right. Everyone said, oh, please, would you stay? I stayed. 99% was good, but 100% of the caliphate. We took out Soleimani. Yeah. We took out al-Baghdadi. Yeah. We took out people that nobody thought possible. Al-Baghdadi was the biggest terrorist of them all. They couldn't find him.
Estados Unidos es tan, 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 tan pinche imperialista. O sea, invariablemente de qué presidente esté, Estados Unidos es una porquería de país. O sea, en serio, discúlpenme, pero nomás escucharlos cómo se manejan y cómo se hacen las cosas. Digo, no que los otros países grandes no sean exactamente lo mismo, güey. Pero ¿cómo puede ser, güey, que con todo el conocimiento, toda la información que tenemos, la transparencia global, sigan sin existir grandes organismos internacionales que regulen este tipo de intervención? O sea, son países que son fundamentalmente intervencionistas e imperialistas. O sea... Son países que nada más llegan a hacer cagaderos en otros países para desestabilizarlos y beneficiarse económicamente. Es que es un asco esto, es un asco.
I took him out. Soleimani, even bigger. I took him out. I've done things that no other president's done. Fortunately, not too many. They should have never been in the Middle East. The decision to go to the Middle East and get into the Middle East was the single biggest mistake made in the history of our country. That's my opinion.
You told Fox News recently that you couldn't say whether you'd accept the results of the 2020 election. What does that actually look like as the sitting president? I mean, it's unprecedented. What would that actually look like?
Clinton never accepted
him. She conceded on it.
She got that's important very easily.
That's important. She conceded on election night. Now, she grumbled about it and said all sorts of things.
Grumbled?
Okay,
she wrote books. I use the word grumbled.
Fine.
But she wrote books about it.
That's fine. But
she got beaten easily.
I get it.
306 to 223.
I'm not disputing you beat Hillary Clinton.
That's a lot.
Listen, what I'm asking is you'll be the sitting president in the White House. What does that look like?
I'll tell you what it looks like.
Are you litigating?
Let me tell you what it looks like.
Okay.
So we have a new phenomena. It's called mail-in voting, where you send where a governor...
Well, it's been here since the Civil War.
In terms of the kind of millions and millions of ballots, they've never...
It'll be bigger this year because of the pandemic.
Bigger? Not bigger. Massively bigger.
Yeah, because of the pandemic.
So they're going to send tens of millions of ballots to California, all over the place. Who's going to get them? I have a friend who lives in Westchester County.
They send applications, not that.
His son passed away. He had a beautiful, wonderful son. Young man. Passed away 7 years ago. He called me. He said, I just got a ballot.
Probably
my son Robert.
Probably
he died 7 years ago. Somebody got a ballot for a dog. Somebody got a ballot for something else. You got millions of ballots going. Nobody even knows where they're going. You look at some of the corruption having to do with universal mail-in voting. Absentee voting is okay. You have to apply. You have to go through a process.
You have to apply
absentee
for mail-in.
Absentee voting
same
is
thing.
Good.
Let's do concrete.
They're sending out
applications. Governors,
millions of ballots.
No, they're not. There's applications.
There is no way you can go through a mail-in vote without massive cheating.
I honestly don't understand this topic with
go
you.
Ahead.
The Republican Party has an extremely well-funded vote-by-mail program. Your campaign puts out emails telling people to vote by mail.
Correct.
Your daughter-in-law, Lara Trump, she did robocalls in California saying it's safe and secure, mail-in voting.
Let me tell you.
The Republican
we have
won.
No choice.
That was an all-mail-in race.
Let me tell you. Are you ready?
Yeah.
We have no choice. Because right now we have many court cases that we're waiting. We have one filed in Western Pennsylvania. We have many court cases where we're trying to end it. We went through World War I, you went to the polls, you voted. We went through World War II, you went to the polls, you
voted. Mail-in voting
and now because of the China virus, we're supposed to stay home, send millions of ballots all over the country, millions and millions. You know, you could have a case where this election won't be decided on the evening of November 3rd.
Absolutely.
This election could
What's
be decided 2 months later.
It won't be 2 months. What's wrong with the proper mailing count?
It could be decided many months later.
Have you discussed
it? You know why? Because lots of things will happen during that period of time, especially when you have tight
margins.
Lots of things can happen. There's never been anything like this when you try. Now, of course, right now we have to.
Este güey, a mí se me hace que Trump ya sabe que va a perder. De hecho, o sea, me suena y lo que he leído también es que los republicanos también se están empezando a alejar de él. No me sorprende, ¿eh? O sea, lo están usando de carne de cañón, tanto en CNN, en Fox también ya se empezaron a hacer mierda. Se me hace que este güey ya debe estar en las últimas. La pregunta ahorita es, ya para mí la pregunta se vuelve qué pasa con Trump después de las elecciones. O sea, me pregunto si va a tener el mismo camino, por ejemplo, no sé si vieron, pero ahora, por ejemplo, están persiguiendo al expresidente de Colombia. Y se los aseguro que cuando el presidente de Brasil sea o impeached o bajado a la presidencia, también va a acabar en el bote el presidente de Brasil. O sea, y me gusta que sea así. O sea, no estoy de acuerdo que se use el aparato legal simplemente para hacer persecución política y para hacer oscilación de poder artificial, pero sí se tiene que perseguir a los políticos corruptos. O sea, yo sí estoy muy, muy de acuerdo con eso. Y creo que Trump va a ser uno de ellos también. To live with it, but we're challenging it in many courts all over the country. Mr. President, the other day a reporter asked you about Ghislaine Maxwell. You said, quote, I just wish... le va a preguntar sobre la pedofilia. Agárrense, cabrón. A ver su cara. Well, frankly, I've met her numerous times over the years, especially since I lived in Palm Beach, but I wish her well, whatever it is. Mr. President, Ghislaine Maxwell has been arrested on allegations of child sex trafficking. Why would you wish such a person well?
I don't know that, but I do know that...
She has. She's been arrested for that.
Her
that.
Friend or boyfriend...
Epstein.
...was either killed or committed suicide in jail. She's now in jail.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I wish you well. I'd wish you well. I'd wish a lot of people well. Good luck. Let them prove somebody was guilty. I mean, you do know that...
Oh, so you're saying you hope she doesn't die in jail. Is that what you mean by wish her well?
Her boyfriend died in jail, and people are still trying to figure out how did it happen. Was it suicide? Was he killed? And I do wish her well. I'm not looking for anything bad for her. I'm not looking bad for anybody. And they took that and...
I mean, she's a child.
Big deal. But all it is right. Her boyfriend died. He died in jail. Was he killed? Was it suicide? I do. I wish her well.
Let's move to Portland. I'm sure you've seen the
disturbing... Ay, no mames, nomás le voy a preguntar eso. Chingados, pinche joto, güey. Nah, hombre, le han de haber puesto un alto para que no se metiera el tema, güey. Pues está demasiado hot el tema de Epstein como para que le haya hecho nada más esa preguntita así toda superficial. Ah, qué decepción.
Footage of people in fatigues beating the Navy veteran.
No. Well, here you go. The fake news.
It's not fake news. It's on video.
For 59 days, these people were anarchists and agitators and some protesters, but these were anarchists. Okay. These people were beating the hell out of the city. They were beating up our federal buildings and our federal courthouse. We told the police to stop it. You make sure. And the police wouldn't do it. Not the police.
Your own Justice Department and Homeland Security Inspector General.
Excuse me.
Your Inspector General are investigating unconstitutional.
You're trying now to blame law enforcement instead of anarchists.
I'm not.
Of Antifa.
I'm not.
It's Antifa and anarchists that are causing the problems, not law enforcement. Our law enforcement, if we didn't have people at our courthouse, and they're strong, tough people, and they don't want, they try and be very good, believe me, but if we didn't have people there, you would have your federal courthouse, $600 million building, you would have that thing burned to the ground.
I'm asking you about tactics and about the unmarked vans where they're rounding people up, and
let me
finish my question, because it relates to this, I promise. This is from Rand Paul, quote, we cannot give up liberty for security. Local law enforcement can and should be handling these situations in our cities, but there is no place for federal troops or unidentified federal agents rounding people up at will. What is your response to Senator Paul?
First of all, these are Homeland Security people. They're securing a courthouse.
They're Border Patrol.
They're Homeland Security.
Elite units.
Border. Hopefully they have
camo,
ice in there. Hopefully they have ice. Now, do you know why they're unmarked? Because
why?
These terrorists, these Antifa people, these people that are anarchists and agitators, when they see the name on a uniform of a person, a policeman or law enforcement person, they find out where that person lives. And then they go and they scare the hell out of the person's family. And so they do it for that reason. It's just common sense. There's nothing secret about this. And you know it. You see it. What's going on right now. We have Chad Wolf. They have people. He's doing a fantastic job. He's the acting head. He's doing a fantastic job. Chad Wolf has pickets out, very dangerous looking people outside of his house. He's going to be just fine. He's tough and he's got people. But if you have the names on all of these uniforms, you'll have these maniacs in front of their houses scaring their family.
No mames. Esto es tipo tácticas nivel nazi, güey. O sea, la policía tiene que identificarse. O sea, es parte de las leyes de que un ciudadano tiene derecho de saber quién es policía y quién no es policía. La policía tiene la obligación de declararse y presentarse como tal. O sea, esto de tener una policía secreta que no se anuncia, no se presenta, se viste de civil, es algo muy, muy, muy grave, ¿eh? O sea, este pedo está a nivel Gestapo, güey. O sea, está a nivel nazi, cabrón.
And their wives and or husbands, whatever it may be. I think it's a very good reason not to have your name. Why should you have identification? My name is Bill Smith, and here's where I live, and I'm a member of...
The really serious concern is...
The serious concern
is the reports of people being rounded up and not being told why they're being detained. That's what's being investigated.
Why?
The inspectors generals.
You know why they're being detained? Well,
there's an investigation. Do you support that investigation?
Well, I haven't seen the result yet.
But do you support the initiative of it?
No, I think that actually... I think Antifa should be investigated, not the law enforcement. They're investigating...
They shouldn't be investigating.
Have you been watching television?
I have.
Have you been seeing the violence?
Sure.
Now, if you watch NBC News, like I watch NBC fake news, I'm watching it, Lester Holt, real beauty, and I'm watching this NBC News sham, and you have a mayor named Wheeler, and he's standing out there, and he's being accosted by the people. You know that. I mean, it's horrible what they're doing to him, Portland, the mayor of Portland. And he thought he'd go out, he'd be a man. What they were doing and saying and everything else to him, I happened to watch it on a different station. He had to get out, he had five security guards. He got out with his life. Okay.
Mr. President,
if you watch, wait, if you watch NBC News, they make him like he's standing there bravely fighting with the people in a positive sense, that everything is wonderful. No, he went out there, he's lucky he got away with his life because they would have killed him. He had five guards, but NBC News showed it like he's standing with the people for justice. Look, those people, take a look at the, what they've done to the courthouse. Take a look at what they've done to the streets. Take a look at the violence.
It's getting worse since they've gone in.
No, actually it's getting better. We had a very good, we've arrested a lot of people, and we now have a 10-year rule. You knock down, you try and knock
down our
courthouse.
More businesses damage, more
violence. You touch our courthouse, you go to jail for 10 years.
Turning to the rest of the country, we haven't seen protests like this since the 60s. I mean, we're seeing—
These are Democrats.
Well, just, if I can finish my question.
Cities, and they're doing it for political reasons.
You said you've done so much for African Americans.
I have.
But...
Es que no mames. O sea, ya todo es campaña. Básicamente, todo lo que tienes que escuchar es que esto es campaña. O sea, no hay ni una gota de verdad o intento objetivo de producir una conversación. Esto es una campaña política. Todo es campaña política. Esto es el cáncer del marketing en el mundo. ¿Ok? O sea, este es el cáncer de la gente que promueve tanto el pensamiento del marketing en el mundo. O sea, si me encantaría un mundo sin marketing, la neta. Mientras más lo pienso, mejor, güey. O sea, porque esto es culpa del marketing. O sea, el marketing es el tipo de persona sin fundamentos que le dice, no, manipula el discurso, voltea la narrativa, cambia el storytelling para allá, enfoca la conversación en otra cosa. O sea, esto es puro marketing. O sea, la política se volvió un circo de marketing. Se acabó la seriedad. O sea, se acabó completamente la seriedad de la política. O sea, Trump para mí marca un parteaguas muy cabrón. Ya era, ¿no? Porque pues era el primer presidente celebrity de un superpotencia del mundo, pero o sea, esto es el fin del discurso político. Me pregunto qué seguirá de esto. O sea, ojalá y nos dé tanto asco estar aquí que regresemos y no vayamos como la película Ideocracia, que el siguiente presidente sea un luchador de lucha libre, güey.
There are Americans. Yeah, I understand. But let me finish. There are Americans out in the streets asking for change. Mr. President, have you ever met with a Black Lives Matter activist to hear them out, hear their arguments?
Well, Black Lives Matter started off to me very badly because it was.
Did you ever meet
pigs in a pigs in a blanket, burn them like bacon. That was my first, the first time I ever heard a black. That was 3-4 years ago. Right. Pigs, meaning policemen. Pigs is what they're referring to, in a blanket, fry them like bacon. I thought it was, so I got off to a bad start. I got off to a very bad
start.
Would you meet
with a Black Lives Matter activist?
I would, but I think right now when they paint the sign, nobody's asked for a meeting. Nobody's ever asked me for a meeting. Let me tell you, with African Americans, I'm doing very well. They had the best employment numbers they've ever had. They had the best job numbers they've ever had. They were making more money than they ever made. We were all set until we got hit by China with the virus. Jonathan, there was actually, we were becoming a very unified country.
Do you believe?
Because of success.
I understand. Do you believe though, Mr. President, that many police treat black people differently from white people?
Well, I hope not. I hope
Ay, no mames. ¿Qué preguntas eso? Es obvio, güey.
The knee on the neck was a disgrace, okay? Yeah. It was a disgrace.
I'm talking about, what does systemic racism mean to you?
I hope the answer to that question is no. Does anybody really answer that question accurately?
But what about not hope? Really, what about analysis? What's your cold heart?
I have seen where there is a difference, and I don't want there to be a difference. I don't like that there would be a difference. But with that being said,
why do you think black men are 2.5 times?
White people,
I know, but why do you think black
in
men
in a larger number
in
police have killed white people?
But why do you think black men are 2.5 times more likely to be killed by police than white?
That I don't know, but I don't like it.
But you must have thought
why?
About it.
Why? I don't know why, but I don't like it. I do know this.
Does it speak to something
police
systemic?
Police have killed many white people also.
But proportionally, what does it speak to?
It speaks to something. If that's the number, you're telling
it is
me a number. Okay, if that's a number, it speaks to something that to me is unacceptable.
And what do you do about it then?
Well, I think we've already done a lot
but
of
you
things.
Haven't, it still exists. I understand your achievements. I know what you're going to say. I'm not suggesting you haven't done a lot
I've done
economically.
I've criminal justice
I get it.
Reform.
I'm just saying what changes.
President Obama couldn't
He's
get
not my friend.
He tried,
I'm asking about that
he
statistic.
Tried, but he couldn't get it done.
Not,
I got criminal justice.
I get it.
I got opportunity zones. I took care of the historically black. You know, if you look at what I've done for colleges, for black colleges and universities, I got them funding. Obama never did it. I did more for the black community than anybody, with the possible exception of Abraham.
Siempre saca estas cosas, güey. O sea, qué cagante que cada vez que diga algo, diga, soy el mejor, he hecho más que cualquier otra persona. O sea, qué hueva, porque hay tantas mentiras que desmentir. O sea, hay tantas cosas que son falsas que nunca llegas al punto real. O sea, básicamente se construye una muralla de excremento y esconde su punto de vista detrás. Y estás todo el tiempo nadando en diarrea, tratando de buscar algo de qué platicar real, y nunca llegas, porque pues básicamente lo que hace es blindarse con esta... Castillo de cacao.
Lincoln, whether you like it or not, people say, oh, that's...
You really, you believe you did more than Lyndon Johnson, who passed the Civil Rights Act?
I think I did, yeah.
How?
Because I got prison justice reform done. I got prison reform.
Lyndon Johnson.
I've done things.
He passed the Civil Rights Act.
How has it worked out? If you take a look at what Lyndon Johnson did,
you think Civil Rights
how has it worked
mistake?
Out? Because frankly, it
¿Por qué ahora estás debatiendo con él sobre eso? O sea, esta es la trampa. O sea, te ponen una mentira y tú tratando de desvalidar la mentira, ya te ganchaste con él en un discurso que no lleva nada y perdiste completamente el punto. ¿Qué pedo con esta gente? No, güey, así no se entrevista, cabrón. O sea, Quédate con tu plan de la pregunta que tenías originalmente, que era qué ha hecho por los afroamericanos y cómo mejorar sus situaciones de vida y cómo mejorar su calidad de vida y su lectura sobre el racismo sistemático en Estados Unidos en referencia a las quejas de Black Lives Matter. ¿Por qué lo estás comparando contra un presidente muerto para ver quién hizo más y caer en la subjetividad interpretativa de si es más o menos que el güey que quitó la esclavitud? Es obvio. Al momento de darle este criterio de compararlo, le estás dando validez a su punto. No platiques de las cosas que son obvias históricas.
Jonathan, under my administration, African Americans were doing better than they had ever done in the history of this country.
Ta madre,
so I did a lot. Job numbers, all of the money they had, money they were getting great. Their percentage was up. Their housing ownership was up. They did better than they've ever done.
But so we got hit.
And now you know what we're doing? I'm building it up again. We're going to have it. Next year will be a great year, unless it's screwed up by somebody that doesn't know what he's doing, which could happen, but I don't think it will.
John Lewis is lying in state in the U.S. Capitol. How do you think history will remember John Lewis?
I don't know. I really don't know. I don't know. I don't know John Lewis. He chose not to come to my inauguration. He chose. I never met John Lewis, actually. I don't believe.
Do you find him impressive?
I can't say one way or the other. I find a lot of people impressive. I find many people not impressive. But no, but I didn't.
Do you find his story impressive?
He didn't come to my inauguration. He didn't come to my State of the Union speeches. And that's okay. That's his right. And again, nobody has done more for Black Americans than I have.
I understand.
He should have come. I think he made a big mistake.
But taking your relationship with him out of it, do you find his story impressive, what he's done for this country?
He was a person that devoted a lot of energy and a lot of heart to civil rights, but there were many others also.
There's a petition to rename the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, Alabama, as the John Lewis Bridge. Would you support that idea?
I would have no objection to it if I'd like to do it.
Yeah, it's a good idea.
Would have no objection to it whatsoever.
Mr. President, you've been so generous with your time, and we really appreciate it.
Well, thank you.
Much.
Great honor.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Qué mugrero entrevista.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Qué mugrero entrevista. No dijeron absolutamente nada relevante, güey. ¿Quieren ver algo realmente relevante? Les enseño esto, güey. Este es el video que todos tienen que ver. Manufacturing consent. Consent. Noam Chomsky. Vamos a buscar Al Jazeera. Este es el bueno. Es un video cortito, dura 4 minutos. Este sí es un video que tienen que ver. De hecho, si alguien está viendo esto y quiere ayudarme con los clips, como me ayudó Diego Saurio, que la neta, Diego Saurio, eres el MVP, güey. La mamaste con los clips que sacaste de los videos de ayer. Muchas gracias. Creo que este clip está interesante. O sea, esto me interesa que la gente lo vea. Es cómo funcionan los medios masivos y la idea de cómo se construye una narrativa política integrada a partir de los medios masivos. Vamos a ver. Iniciamos.
Propaganda. Many use the word when.
Ah, mira, este sí está en español. Perfecto que está en español. Perfecto.
Talking about countries like North Korea, Kazakhstan, Iran. Countries viewed as authoritarian through the lens of the Western media. Press freedom. Freedom of thought. People use those terms when talking about countries like the United States, France, Australia, democracies. In 1988, Noam Chomsky co-authored a book with Edward Herman called Manufacturing Consent. It blasted apart the notion that media acts as a check on political power.
Claro, a ver, aquí lo que tienen que entender como premisa. Siempre se ha hablado políticamente de cuatro poderes, o tres poderes más uno, ¿no? O sea, la idea es que está el poder ejecutivo, legislativo, judicial, que son los poderes del Estado, y después está el cuarto poder, que hay diferentes interpretaciones. De hecho, creo que Bolívar es el que decía que el cuarto poder realmente es la moral del pueblo, o sea, es la moral de la gente, que la neta filosóficamente hace mucho sentido, porque si el pueblo no tiene moral, pues muchos de los otros poderes van a ser, de alguna manera repercutir o capitalizar en la falta moral del pueblo. Pero también hay teorías que sostienen que los medios son el cuarto poder. O sea, los medios libres son el cuarto poder, ¿ok? Tengan mucha atención con esta noción de medios libres. ¿Por qué? Porque los medios libres son los que reportan los abusos de los otros tres poderes. Entonces, hay un poder que es el poder de la transparencia, de la comunicación y de la accountability, que supuestamente son los medios. Entonces, en el 88, Chomsky publicó este libro, que es una chulada de trabajo, que habla sobre cómo realmente esto es falso. O sea, los medios no son el cuarto poder o no actúan como un cuarto poder que mantiene en jaque a los otros tres poderes. Porque a fin de cuentas también acuérdense que los tres poderes dentro de un Estado también están para protegerse uno de los otros. O sea, que el Ejecutivo no pueda hacerlo todo, que el Legislativo tenga solo cierto nivel de capacidad de injerencia sobre cómo se manejan las legislaciones y el Judicial sobre la parte de juicios, los jueces y demás, ¿no? Pero, o sea, vale la pena que entiendan esto específicamente de por qué el cuarto poder está completamente corrompido.
That media inform the public, serve the public, so that we can better engage in the political process. In fact, media manufacture our consent. They tell us what those in power need them to tell us so we can fall in line. Democracy is staged with the help of media that work as propaganda machines. Media operate through five filters. The first has to do with ownership. Mass media firms are big corporations. Often, they're part of even bigger conglomerates. Their endgame, profit. And so it's in their interest to push for whatever guarantees that profit. Critical journalism takes second place to the needs and interests of the corporation.
A ver, este es el primero. O sea, el primero es que el filtro es la ganancia. O sea, que a grandes rasgos las corporaciones pues buscan ganancia. Entonces, no puedes tener medios demasiado críticos o pensamiento demasiado crítico que critica a los patrocinadores porque pues eso no sería rentable para los medios. Y les cuento aquí algo muy personal. O sea, yo en mi review de noticias pues no me he tenido que detener por ningún comentario porque pues digo, no estoy atado financieramente a ninguna de las cosas de las que hablo, ¿ok? Pero pues obviamente hay un conflicto de interés. O sea, en el momento que es de que, oye, pues llegas al punto, y se los juro que es un punto muy cercano, donde si hablas mal de una marca que trabaja contigo, ya no trabajan contigo. Entonces llegas a un punto donde es, sí, a lo mejor puedes hablar mal de todo el mundo, pero ¿cómo vas a vivir? O sea, ¿de dónde vas a ganar dinero? Y eso pues te pone en una paradoja muy, 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 muy difícil.
The second filter exposes the real role of advertising. Media costs a lot more than consumers will ever pay.
Claro.
So who fills the gap?
Las marcas.
Advertisers. And what are the advertisers paying for? Audiences.
Claro.
And so it isn't so much that the media are selling you a product, their output. They're also selling advertisers a product.
Tú.
You. How does the establishment manage the media? That's the third filter.
Yeah.
Journalism cannot be a check on power because the very system encourages complicity.
Hey.
Governments, corporations, big institutions know how to play the media game. They know how to influence the news narrative. They feed media scoops, official accounts, interviews with the experts. They make themselves crucial to the process of journalism. So those in power and those who report on them are in bed with each other. If you want to challenge power, you'll be pushed to the margins.
Claro.
Your name won't be down. You won't be getting in. You've lost your access. You've lost the story. When the media, journalists, whistleblowers, sources, stray away from the consensus, they get flack. That's the fourth filter. When the story is inconvenient for the powers that be, you'll see the flack machine in action, discrediting sources, trashing stories, and diverting the conversation. To manufacture consent, you need an enemy, a target. That common enemy is the fifth filter.
El enemigo.
Terrorists, immigrants, a common enemy, a boogeyman to fear helps corral public opinion. Five filters, one big media theory. Consent.
Manufacturing consent. Bueno, pueden sacar por favor el clip porque tengo que contestar una llamada. A rato me